to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Ib Melchior, is one of those names that whenever there's science fiction mentioned or a convention, his name will be there because he had connections with six films that have become cult films from the 60s. The book is published by Bear Publishing, and welcome, Ib.
Thank you, Connie. Good to see you.
If I am yelling a little bit, we'll tell the friends in the audience a little problem hearing.
A little problem indeed.
Now, you're born in Denmark, and it is there that you first see a film that was a shocker, a horror film, of a man who had the smiling face that later we see in Batman as the Joker.
It was called The Man Who Laughs, and it was actually a Victor Hugo classic, L'Homme qui rit.
Yeah.
Charles II, who revenges himself on a nobleman by taking his son and cutting his lips off. It was terrible, and I loved it.
And from there, of course, is World War II. You have been in America, you volunteer, and you speak six languages, and was with the OSS prior to it being CIA.
CIC, yes.
Yeah. Now, during this period, you come back, and all you really want to do is come to Hollywood and be a film director.
I wanted to do that ever since I saw the first film.
Yeah. Now, in order to do that, you've got to join the union, the Directors Guild, and...
Well, I used to be a director in television, live television, in New York. I did the Perry Como Show and several other musicals and a couple of other films. And I belonged to the RTDG, which is the Directors Union in New York. I came out here and found out, no way, here it is, the Directors Guild of America. So I couldn't do anything. How do you become a member? Well, it's almost impossible. You have to find somebody who will say, only Ib Melchior can direct my film. Where would I find this? I didn't know anybody here, you know.
But you did find a man named Pink.
Yes.
And he said, if you write this script for minimum, I will hire you as a director for minimum.
That was my condition, yes, indeed. Well, he had tried to get somebody. He had a story, what was called Invasion of Mars. And he had tried to get somebody to write a screenplay that he liked and been unsuccessful. And I thought, I'd never written a screenplay in my life. I didn't even know what they looked like. But I thought, well, why not? So I wrote it for him and with the stipulation that if he liked it, if he didn't like it, he didn't have to buy it. If he liked it and bought it, then I also directed. Yeah. Well, he liked it, so I became a director.
But the next picture, he decides, if you could direct it, he should be able to direct it. When you end up getting, a deal in Denmark?
Yeah. Well, the first film, he had another producer with him, Norman Morrow, who was very, very talented. If it hadn't been for Norman, it wouldn't have been a film at all. But Mr. Pink wanted to do more than... he was an exhibitor.
Yeah.
So he decided to produce and direct and act in it and sweep the stage. I think he did everything. Yeah. And he did it in Denmark. Well, unfortunately, the result was...
Yeah.
AIP did not... accepted. It was just unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
And they hired me to sort of fix it up, which I did. It was, first one was Reptilicus.
Yeah.
Which was a good story, but somehow it takes more than just wanting to direct a picture. You have to have some knowledge of it. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, Mr. Pink.
Yeah.
Didn't.
Now, Reptilicus became sort of really a cult name and figure.
It has been just recently, in fact, earlier this year, the most prestigious theater in Denmark is the Royal Theater in Copenhagen. Mm-hmm. That's where the Danish Ballet is and so forth. They took Reptilicus and made it into a stage play, and it was performed at the Royal Theatre in Copenhagen on the stage just earlier this year.
And the Time Travelers?
The Time Travelers were my favorite.
Yeah.
I teamed up with a young man named David Hewitt, who was an amateur magician, and he knew about all kinds of illusions that that the magicians make. And we decided to take those illusions, alter them a little to serve our purpose.
Yeah.
And every one of the special effects in that film took place right on the stage. It was a magician's illusion. For instance, in one shot, we had something called an android, which is a robot shaped like a human being. And this android has his head injured. And you see him coming in. He lies down on a flat table. This was all in one shot. You never took your camera away from him. He lies down on the table. Somebody takes his head and pulls it off.
Yeah.
He gets a new head, puts it on, taps it on the shoulder, and the man walks away again.
Is that the show that the man called you and said, you said, what are you calling me for? And he said, I'm a monster.
That was Pete Strudwick, who was a Mensa, actually. And he was born without feet and without hands. Instead of hands, he had lobster claws like this. And in feet, he had panel pads. He ran the marathon. Yeah. He ran the marathon with Cap Pendleton and beat half of the Marines.
Yeah.
And he was absolutely amazing.
Time Travelers has a bit of a feeling of Eugene Roddenberry's the show that William Shatner was in.